Hello and welcome. Today on the sofa we have Astra, who's running for Wellbeing Officer. Please tell us a bit about yourself and why you're running for this position.
Okay, so obviously my name's Astra. I'm a third year politics and sociology student, and I'm running this for this position because I saw that there was a massive need for someone who's like me and sort of a part of a minority group.
Okay.
That there needs representation for. I feel like, especially with the union as it is now, there is a lot of sort of same, and there's not really much exposure for especially ethnic minority groups who have sort of issues with mental illness and things like that.
Okay.
So I did really want to address that issue, and that's why I decided to run for Wellbeing.
Okay, so continuing with that, what would your number one priority be if you were elected?
That's a difficult question because I do feel as though everything that I put on my manifesto is really important. That's why it's on my manifesto.
Yeah.
One of the main things I would definitely say is sort of removing the stigma of mental illness and mental health issues and within like the Black and ethnic minority communities, because I know, you know, as my, like, I'm half Indian, half Jamaican, and I know, like, regardless of sort of what family member I'm sort of around, everyone's sort of like, you know, we don't talk about that, like, it's like you deal with it by yourself.
Okay.
And I think you know, it's important to sort of bring that to the forefront, especially in a place where we are really multi-ethnic, and you know, there is a lot of opportunities for sort of discussion about mental illness, but it never really happens.
Okay, so how like specifically do you want to go down, like bringing up more, you know, more diversity and more opportunities for the minorities?
I think it starts with representation. I think if you feel as though somebody represents, you know, what you stand for, who you are, and sort of you can see like yourself within them, you are more likely to sort of open yourself to like the policies that they're, you know, sort of offering. And I know a lot of the contenders for the Wellbeing position do have quite similar sorts of policies to that I do in terms of sort of like mental well-being, but none of them are catered specifically to the people that need them. Like I know that Black women in particular are disproportionately at risk of developing mental health issues and that sort of thing, and I feel like by sort of targeting that group and being able to sort of open up a dialogue between, you know, even if it is just in their own circles, then at least, you know, there is some sort of conversation going on and it lessens the stigma.
Okay, so behind all your wonderful ideas, has there been like a specific motivation, something that's really motivated you to, you know, go for this position and do what you want to do?
Well, I have had a lot of dealings with the mental health facilities here at the university.
Okay.
And just in general throughout my life, I've sort of been in and out of like mental illness myself and things like that, so I know what people are going through and how people are coping with certain things. And you know, the facilities we already have at the university are really good, but there's always room for improvement. And I feel like, again, you know, with representation and things like that, like a lot of the students at university don't feel as though, you know, with like the limitations on counseling sessions you can have and things like that, that there's no point in going because, you know, they're not going to be like very well represented and that sort of thing. So I feel like that's part of the reason why.
Okay, so you just briefly touched on services that the university already has.
Mm-hmm.
So a couple of things they do have is like a nightline, a mental well-being and counseling service, further workshops and, you know, like various drop-in sessions.
Mm-hmm.
Do you not think that instead of having a well-being officer, we need better promotion of these services which already are in place? And, you know, with respect, a well-being officer, you know, someone that doesn't really have training.
Mm-hmm.
So would promotion not just be a better idea?
That's a fair question, to be honest, but I think in terms of myself, I do have a lot of experience in sort of mentoring and sort of mental health things like that.
Okay.
So I've done a lot of work with young people who suffer from disabilities and behavioural management issues and things like that as well. So in that respect, I do have, you know, sort the sort of training,
yeah,
that's available. But I think, you know, if there isn't someone who is working in the wellbeing sort of forum, who else is going to be able to actively promote these businesses, organizations. Like, you know, the organizations themselves can promote them, but there's only so much they can do. And I think in terms of having a broad sort of spectrum of reach, I think you need one figurehead for all sorts of, all of the organizations that can be like, okay, so this is what we have on offer, blah, 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 blah. And, you know, like, if this doesn't work for you, then this. It's all about offering different opportunities for different people. It has to be catered. It can't just be a blanket for everyone, because mental health isn't a blanket for everyone. And physical health and being protected and things like that, it's not a blanket for everyone. So you need individual.
Yeah, true. Just drifting aside from, you know, the mental and illnesses side, house prices, they're quite dear to, you know, they're close to students and their well-being. How would you go around maybe tackling this problem?
In my manifesto, I did speak about having a sort of compare the meerkat cat type situation, where what letting agencies would do, would they'd put the information about the student houses that they'd have available on the site, and the university would do the same with like halls and things like that. And then what students would be able to do is they'd be able to narrow down their searches. So say we want to live with seven people and we want to spend so and so money a week, and then the search engine would come up with houses that fit that criteria.
Could you not already do that online on comparison sites?
I think with Leicester in particular, with like, it doesn't highlight student accommodation as well. I think a lot of second and third years and like postgrads completely forget that living in halls is an option, and that we do get a sort of like premiercy over like, you know, first year students and stuff like that in terms of being able to come back and like live in halls. So I feel like that element to the whole like being able to compare residencies and stuff like that isn't available. So having it all at in one place just makes it so much easier, and it just makes it more viable for students. As well, I was talking about having a housing fair where you have all the letting agencies there physically, you can speak to them, like they obviously hand out leaflets and all that sort of thing. And do you know what, like, they're naturally going to want to compete with each other. That's what it is. It's a business at the end of the day. And the uni will be there as well to be able to promote their housing and things like that as well. So it is all about sort of people being astute enough to make their own decisions about, you know, what letting agency they saw that worked best for them and that sort of thing. So it's all about giving students the choice.
Okay, so continuing with the idea of, you know, expenses and stuff, would you aim to provide cheaper or healthier food options around the uni? Because, you know, currently in the canteens, the cafes, the food prices are kind of on the high. So how would you go around this issue?
We as students, when we wouldn't be at university if we weren't, you know, self-sufficient. And I think it's all about being able to make your own decisions. You know, some days you're going to want to eat rubbish, and some days you're going to want to eat quinoa for every meal of the day. It's all up to you. And I think price is probably, you know, on the top of everybody's list, but I know more than anyone that healthy food isn't cheap. And, you know, it isn't easy to access cheap meals and things like that that are really healthy. So I think there needs to be a balance and a mixture, but I don't feel as though we should completely eradicate, like, you know, the odd sort of burrito here and there, because at the end of the day, if it was completely like salad everywhere, people are only gonna like go to the Queen's Road and find like a Subway or something like that there. Do you know what I mean? So I think,
okay, so it says here you've aimed to open the sports center on campus and in Oadby for longer. First of all, is it, wouldn't you think that's maybe something to do with the sports officer in and not really the wellbeing officer?
Wellbeing is about everything, mind, body, soul. And I feel like as a wellbeing officer, you know, I would be able to look at sort of people's timetables, people's lives, and you have to have your facilities cater to people's lives. A lot of the time, we don't have the time to do anything. Like, I know I haven't been able to go to the gym all week because I've been like campaigning and that sort of thing. And I know that if the gym was open longer, then I'd be able to sort of get in there, get my workout on. So it's kind of like, it's one of those things where you really want to go to the gym, but it's like, I don't have the time. And I was saying earlier about the gym being open slightly longer as well, that we wouldn't have to have staff there necessarily. If we make sure that the obviously the swimming pool and like every other the room facilities are locked, and all it is that you just use the gym.
Yeah.
And I think a lot of the people that would be using those facilities are people that are regular gym goers anyway, so that, you know, they'd know the equipment, they'd know everything, and staff are only sort of needed for like booking classes and that sort of admin thing that usually happens during the day anyway. So I don't see how, you know, in terms of having to like pay extra people to be there and that sort of thing, how that would be an issue.
Okay, so sticking with the idea of, you know, making it open longer, what times and how exactly are you going to do this? You know, what's your strategies towards this? Have you worked out like costs and, you know?
Well, my sort of premise was the sort of pure gym sort of structure.
Yeah.
So it's the kind of you swipe in, you swipe out, that kind of thing. I think in terms of running the gym and costs, the costs would be quite low considering that, you know, you're not paying for extra staff to be there. And if there was any for staff, they'd only have to be like one staff member maximum, because at the end of the day, you know, they're only there to sort of support at that time as opposed to anything else. And what you could do in terms of having staff as well is that you could have the sports societies or you know, someone to do sports, maybe the sports officer oversee the sort of gym situation.
Okay.
So what they'd do is like one of them would volunteer every day sort of thing to come in and like spend a couple of hours there or what have you. So again, that keeps costs down as well.
Okay, so before we end off this interview, we're gonna do like a quick game.
Ooh, okay.
It's a word association game, I'm sure you're aware of it. So yeah. I'm gonna fire out some quick fire words, and the first word that comes into your head, just shout it out.
Okay.
So the first word is union.
Equality.
Well-being.
Health.
Students.
Drunk.
Inspiration.
I don't know. I think of the word colour. I don't know.
Okay, we'll go with colour. Right. Astra.
Oh, star.
Lost.
Fantastic.
Goal.
Change.
Me. Leicester.
Fab.
Thank you so much, Astra. Good luck with the elections.
Thank you. Cheers.